Here's a trivia question. Name as many musical instruments as you can which were named after their creator. Okay, let's see. There was the saxophone. That was invented in the 1840s by a Belgian dude named Adolphe Sax. Then there was Leo Theremin. He invented a spooky, weird electronic instrument called the theremin that's been used by everyone from the Beach Boys and Led Zeppelin to current bands like Athlete and Goldfrapp. Maybe we'd better mention Les Paul and the electric guitars he inspired. Some people insist that he was the inventor of the electric guitar, which isn't completely accurate, but we'll sort of add him to the list with the famous Les Paul guitar. And I guess in that regard, we could talk about Leo Fender. His company became synonymous with Fender Stratocasters and Telecasters, not to mention an innovative line of amplifiers, but that's, you know, more of a brand name. And after that, well, unless there was a Mr. Drum or a Miss Piano that we don't know about, that's about it, right? Well, not quite. In 1963, an electrical engineer came up with a voltage-controlled device that could make electricity useful in a musical way. In 1964, that device made its debut at the Electronic Music Studio at the University of Toronto. And you know something? Music really hasn't been the same ever since. The name of the device was the Moog synthesizer, and this is how its inventor, Robert Moog, changed everything.
Now, the ongoing history of new music.
Thank you.
Just Can't Get Enough from Depeche Mode, a band that started to take shape when a bank teller named Martin Gore saved up enough money to buy himself his first ever Moog synthesizer back in 1978. Along with earlier pioneers like Kraftwerk and David Bowie, as well as contemporaries like OMD and Softcell, Depeche Mode led a charge into electronics that changed the way we perceive and compose music. And much of this would not have been possible without the contributions of the late Robert Moog, who died of a brain tumor on August 21st, 2005. Hello, I'm Alan Cross, and this show is a tribute to Bob and his device, which could very well be the last true musical invention that we will see in our lifetimes. Because we've been so well served by guitars and drums and pianos and organs, inventing a new musical instrument is hard. Not that people haven't tried. Ever hear of the jazzophone? It looked like a double horn saxophone and came out in the 1920s, but no one cared. How about the double harp? It looked like a double version of that thing angels play, but it was impossible to play and it flopped. A more recent attempt was an instrument called the stick, which looks like this big, fat, thick guitar neck with 12 strings. I think it has 12 strings, which is insanely difficult to play. Tony Levin, the bass player in Peter Gabriel's band, is probably the world's most famous stick player, which tells you a lot right there. But if you say Moog, people instantly know what you're talking about. And notice the correct pronunciation. It's Moog and not Moog. This is the first rule of talking about synthesizers. Get the name right. This is how Bob wanted his name pronounced, so we gotta go with that. It is the Moog synthesizer and definitely not the Moog synthesizer, despite what habits you may have. Anyway, Bob Moog invented the first portable, practical, and affordable electronic keyboard device. And to understand why this is such a big deal, we have to go back to how things worked in the pre-Moog days. The electronic keyboard has its roots in, believe it or not, the 1700s. That's when a guy named Jean-Baptiste de Laborde came up with an electronic harpsichord. It was a standard harpsichord that could be charged with static electricity, which was then discharged in a controlled manner and resulted in bells being struck with a hammer. In 1857, a dude named Thaddeus Cahill unveiled the teleharmonium, a musical instrument that was purely electronic. It was pretty cool, but it wasn't very practical. First of all, it was the size of a railway car and weighed 7 tons. There were other attempts. There was the Ohms Martineau, the Solovox, the Singing Arc. Then there was the Trautonium, the Emicon, the Electrond, the Novachord, the Obukhov. And let's not forget the revolutionary sackbut, invented by a Canadian named Hugh Lacaine. But all these instruments were bulky and finicky and tough to program with all these knobs and switches and patchcord wires. They were tough to play and hideously expensive. In the 30s, 40s, and 50s, electronic instruments were confined mainly to research labs and universities. Now here's an example of music played on electronic keyboards in the 1950s. This is a classical piece by a composer named Oscar Sala from 1955. It's Concertando Rubato from Elektronische Tanzsuite. Thank you. It's kind of cool, huh? Electronic music from 1955. And this is where Bob Moog enters the picture, almost. Because before we talk about Bob, we got to take a 40-year detour into the past to talk about Professor Leo Theremin. Remember we talked about him at the beginning? Leo was a Bolshevik scientist under Lenin. In 1918, he unveiled an electronic device that he first called the etherphone. But in the peak of Soviet-style vanity, he renamed it after himself. So the theremin was this thing in a box with a rod that stuck out on one side and a loop of metal on the other. And it's played by waving one hand over the rod and one hand over the loop. In other words, you never touched it. When a theremin player plays, it looks like he's conjuring music out of thin air, waving his hand around this box with these two antennas sticking out of it. I think it's the only musical instrument in history that you play without actually, you know, touching it. A theremin is very tough to play. You need a very, very steady hand, and there is absolutely no tactile feedback from the instruments because, you know, you're just simply waving your hands in the air. But when you get it right, you end up with a sound that's a cross between an eerie violin and a ghostly, warbling female opera singer. The theremin's first fan was, believe it or not, Vladimir Lenin. When he wasn't trying to collectivize farms, he was admiring Professor Theremin's contribution to Soviet culture. He even sent Leo on a world tour to promote this new communist technology. And it was all pretty cool for the professor for a while. RCA, one of America's great companies of the 1920s, bought the rights to manufacture theremins in the West. And then the professor found himself a very hot-looking African-American wife. But when World War II started, he was called back to the Soviet Union, where he was caught in a Stalinist purge and ended up being sent to a labor camp for doing something anti-Soviet. We don't know what, it was just bad enough to get Stalin mad. Whatever the case, Theremin later made up for it by inventing the first electronic bugging device, which got a lot of use during the Cold War. Even got a medal for it. Just had to love the USSR, right? Now, everyone has heard of theremin, although you might not know it. Theremins were big in the 1950s when composers needed some futuristic sounding music for a science fiction movie. Like this one. This is the theme from Forbidden Planet from 1956. All right, have you got all that? This is where history finally intersects with Bob Moog. Although you could buy a fully functioning theremin, theremin kits were big hits with electronic geeks. You could buy this kit and assemble it at home. Bob constructed his very first theremin when he was just 15. This was 1949. Didn't work very well. You know, getting the induction coils just right was pretty tricky. But it sure got him into the possibilities of electronic music. He began publishing articles on theremins and became something of an icon with other builders of homemade devices. And by 19, he had his own business, selling complete theremins as well as theremin parts. After graduation, Bob went to school for electrical engineering and physics. When he was at Columbia University, he had a technical advisor named Vladimir Yusachevsky. Now, he was a composer of electronic music and a technical advisor to the Columbia-Princeton Electronic Music Center on the other side of campus. That is where you could find the multi-ton RCA Mark II electronic music synthesizer. Big honkin' thing. And using that device, Yusachevsky made groundbreaking music like this. This is a 1960 composition entitled Wireless Fantasy. Thank you. Even though Yousechevsky was one of Bob Moog's instructors, Bob himself never once visited the room where that big RCA synthesizer lived. He just wasn't that interested. And besides, he was selling up to 1,000 theremin kits a year, so who cared? And when he got out of school, he moved upstate and opened a business that went into theremin manufacturing full-time. It was the only electronic music he really liked. All right, so how did Bob get from making these weird devices to inventing one of the most influential musical instruments of all time? The answer? Tubas and porn. Yes, I said tubas and porn. Details next.
This is the ongoing history of new music. You're tuned to the ongoing history of new music.
Welcome back to this tribute to Robert Moog, the inventor of the first truly portable, practical, and affordable keyboard synthesizer, which, of course, went on to change the course of rock music. We last left Bob in his theremin shop in Ithaca, New York, where he was happy living in an old farmhouse. Bob was also a fan of the tuba, thanks to his friendship with Walter Sear, a designer and manufacturer of tubas, who also had been a porno filmmaker in a previous life. In the winter of 1963, Walter convinced Bob to go to a musical instruments trade show to try and sell more theremins and tubas. And that's where they met a guy named Herb Deutsch, a musician who was dabbling in electronics. They eventually hooked up in New York City, where Herb introduced Bob to some of his friends, who were into this weird new electronic music using some very primitive and finicky gear. Afterwards, Bob and Herb got to talking. Bob wanted to know exactly what kinds of sounds Herb was hoping to get out of his equipment, and how did he want to control that sound? So this got Bob thinking, and he went back to his workshop, where he came up with what became known as a control voltage device. Using another device called an oscillator, it was now possible to precisely control musical pitch. Bottom line is that electricity could be tamed and controlled through an infinite number of tones. Hook it up to a piano-style keyboard, and you had a workable musical instrument. By the summer of 1964, Bob was ready to demonstrate his new instrument at the University of Toronto's Electronics Lab. He made some important contacts with other engineers, and by that fall, he was selling Moog synthesizers. And he sold a few, despite the fact that sometimes it took hours to set up a machine for a specific sound. And although they were still big and bulky, Bob's synthesizers were basically a series of big boxes called modules, connected to each other by patch cords. And a lot of people became excited about the potential of the Moog keyboard synthesizer. These modules could be purchased separately for between $200 and $500 each, or you could buy a complete system for anywhere between $2,800 and $6,200. It was still expensive, but these things were at least portable, and for some, affordable. And when the first product catalog came out in October of 1965, it was the first time these devices were described as synthesizers. Now, as far as anyone can tell, the first recorded appearance of a Moog is on an album entitled Cosmic Sounds by this weird hippie-slash-psychedelic group from Los Angeles called Zodiac. 12 tracks, each devoted to a different horoscope sign. Okay, it was 1967, and there was a lot of LSD around. What do you want me to say?
Endless naked moonlight swims in the green sensational sea. Throbbing with the wave beat. Laughing the lunar laugh. Sobbing in the dark when the moon shrinks.
That is what we think is the first appearance of the Moog synthesizer on a rock record. Zodiac from the summer of 1967. Some of the sounds took up to 30 hours to create. The synth was not exactly what you'd call user-friendly. The first appearance of the synth in music that actually was popular came that November. And this recording didn't come from the Beatles or the Stones or any of the big bands of the day. It came from, wait for it, the Monkees. The Moog Synthesizer from Star Collector, a song from the Monkees, released in November of 1967. Now, that was cool, but it wasn't enough to elevate the synthesizer into public consciousness. There was an appearance of the Moog in the soundtrack of the film The Graduate in 1967. George Harrison started talking about getting one for his work outside the Beatles, but what was really needed was a pre-op transsexual classical composer named Walter Carlos. And again, you heard me correctly, I did say pre-op transsexual classical composer. Walter was very interested in Bob's machine, and he offered all kinds of input into how it could be improved. He also insisted that the primary controller device be a keyboard and not anything else. Bob hadn't been sold on the concept at that point. Believe it or not, he was thinking that a piano-type keyboard was not the way to go. Anyway, in 1968, Walter released Switched on Bach, a classical album where the music was completely rendered from a series of modular Moog synthesizers. The record sold millions and won 3 Grammy Awards, and the synthesizer had finally found its audience. For a while, in the late 1960s, the most famous synthesizer musician in the whole wide world was Walter Carlos. You might also remember his work on the soundtrack of the futuristic Stanley Kubrick film, A Clockwork Orange. Now, before we move on, we should acknowledge what happened to Walter Carlos. After A Clockwork Orange, he dropped from sight for a little gender reassignment surgery and later reappeared as Wendy Carlos. She picked up where he left off and continues to be a very successful and very well-respected electronic musician. By the end of the 1960s, and thanks in very large part to Walter Wendy, the Moog synthesizer had gained a foothold in popular music. There were all these weird bandwagon-jumping records with titles like Nashville Country Moog, and Moog Power, and even The Plastic Cow Goes Moog. Okay, it was the 60s, and again, lots of LSD floating around. But then there was the serious stuff. The Beatles used it for their Abbey Road album. George Harrison released an electronic solo album. And perhaps most importantly, there was Keith Emerson, the keyboard player in the prog rock supergroup Emerson, Lake & Palmer. In 1970, they released their debut album, which featured a single called Lucky Man. And at the very end of the song, Keith played this solo. Now, this seems to be the real beginning of the Moog synthesizer in rock music. And within just a few years, things blew up, and that part of the story is next.
This is the ongoing history of new music. You're tuned to the ongoing history of new music.
This is our look at the contributions of Robert Moog, inventor of the first practical keyboard synthesizer, an instrument that changed everything for rock music. In the early 1970s, there were a number of companies manufacturing keyboard synthesizers. But because Bob got there first, the brand name Moog was kind of used as the de facto name for all keyboard synthesizers, kind of like we use Kleenex to describe tissues or aspirin for a particular type of painkiller. A big part of this has to do with the introduction of the Mini Moog, a single, portable, 44-key unit, half the size of a regular one, that could comfortably sit on a table. The model A, B, C, D, and E. You could have one for about $1,200. And this means that just about anyone could save up and buy one. Bob sold more than 12,000 Mini Moogs. This coincided with a huge uptick in the amount of popular music made on synthesizers. Now, this track originally appeared on a 1968 album entitled Music to Moog By. Then in 1972, it was recorded by a Moog synthesizer dude named Stan Free, along with a group of like-minded studio musicians. It was a major hit, reaching number 5 on the charts and even number 1 in Germany. The group called themselves Hot Butter, and the track is called Popcorn. Hot Butter with Popcorn from 1972. Some of those 60s drugs carried over into that decade. But then in Germany, we had this, the far more ambitious and groundbreaking experimental electronica from Kraftwerk. This is from 1974, and it's their famous worldwide hit, Autobahn.
Thank you.
Kraftwerk with a composition that kicked off wave after wave of German electronic music, much of it powered by various incarnations of Moog synthesizers, including the Mini Moog, the Micro Moog, the Multi Moog, and the Memory Moog. After Kraftwerk, along with the prog rock of Emerson, Lake & Palmer, and the pop of Stevie Wonder and Elton John, and the new vision of David Bowie, and the experimental music of future U2 producer Brian Eno, and then there was French composer Jean-Michel Jarre, the concept of the synthesizer became commonplace. Manufacturers popped up everywhere. Arp, EMS, Oberheim, Roland, Yamaha. Each model was easier to program and play than the last, and more features were added. By the late 1970s, the post-punk generation had embraced the synth. These musicians loved the possibilities of electronics, and they were grateful for the keyboard's forgiving nature. See, they had become so easy to program and play that you really didn't have to be a virtuoso keyboard player to play a synth. All you needed was some cool, simple sounds, and you could sound awesome. Gary Newman from the fall of 1979, big supporter and user of synthesizers made by Robert Moog and his Moog Music Company. And the Moog synth did more than encourage just electronic and technopop music. It became an important component of everything from industrial music to hip-hop, and from funk to trance and techno. Its impact was huge. But back to the capitalism of the situation. Market competition was tough, and eventually Bob sold his interest in his company to a musical instrument manufacturer called Norlin. They didn't do much better and closed down Moog Music in 1987. They just couldn't keep up with the move from analog synths to new digital ones in the middle 1980s. Bob went back to making theremins with his new company called Briar Music. They did okay, but eventually moved to making effects pedals. They also created a plugin for Pro Tools computer software that emulated the classic Moog sound. It's called the Moger Fuger. Seriously, that's what it was called, the Moger Fuger. Bob spent part of the 1990s as a research professor at the University of North Carolina. But then, in 2002, Bob bought back the name Moog Music from the remains of Norlin and started making a new version of the Mini Moog called the Voyager. It's almost identical to the old Model D from the early 1970s, but with some modern touches. He built it, and they came. Nine Inch Nails, Pearl Jam, Sonic Youth, and a ton of others. Meanwhile, a strange thing happened. After decades of working with digital synthesizers, people began to rediscover the classic sounds of the old analog machines, especially those made by the original Moog keyboard company. As sampling became a way to compose music, more people began to uncover the capabilities of old keyboards. There's a warmth and a tonal quality that is utterly unique. And for whatever reason, these classic sounds are hard to properly duplicate on modern digital keyboards. Or that's what they say, anyway. People started looking everywhere for vintage gear in good condition. Prices started going through the roof as a Micro Moog in good condition became a prized collectible. Some people have embraced analog synthesizers full-time. Take the case of Bob Kehoe and Roger Manning. They have a band called the Moog Cookbook, which specializes in stuff like, well, stuff like this. This recording features a Mini Moog for the intro, a Moog Sonic 6 to carry the melody, a Micro Moog for the bass parts, and a Moog Opus 3 to take care of the string parts, among other things. There are other, more commercial acts who love the old-school sounds. There's Air, the French electropop group, Nine Inch Nails, Radiohead, Beastie Boys, and of course, don't forget about Beck. He actually hired Roger Manning from the Moog Cookbook to help him with vintage sounds on his albums. 2005 recording featuring some Moog synthesizer technology that's more than 30 years old. In April of 2005, Bob went to the doctor because something wasn't right. They found a brain tumor, which turned out to be inoperable. And on Sunday, August the 21st, Bob died at his home in Asheville, North Carolina. He was 71. In his honor, the American National Standards Institute, an organization that helps set industrial standards, proposed a new unit of measurement called the, the Moog. A Moog is now a standard unit for expressing volts per octave, which is something you need to know if you're building an analog synthesizer. One Moog means 1 volt per octave, and the abbreviation is MG. And for an engineer, a tribute doesn't get any higher than that. A few final words on Bob Moog and his invention in just a second.
This is the ongoing history of new music. You're tuned to the ongoing history of new music.
Rock and roll's main weapons are, and always have been, the guitar and the drum. Although we've seen tremendous changes in technology, it's hard to imagine our music without these two ancient instruments. However, it's also hard to imagine going forward without the keyboard technology that we got with the many variations of the Moog synthesizer. This is the cool thing about keyboard synthesizers. As soon as musicians began to get their hands on the first Moogs, they began to discover and use sounds that had never, ever been heard before by the human ear. In fact, they began to use sounds that were weirder and more wonderful than anyone could have possibly imagined. As they became cheaper and easier to use, more people got involved. More ideas flooded the world of music. And then the music began to change. Think of all the artificial sounds that have become an integral part of our music. Think how the sonic vistas of all music has expanded to infinity. And think of all the things that came with all these different forms of music. Let me drop this one on you. Would drug use be the same if it weren't for electronic-based music? Think about it. Would ecstasy have taken off as a drug if it weren't for rave music? Okay, I'm just saying. Few inventions, let alone new musical instruments, have had as big or as immediate an impact as what we saw in the 60s, 70s, and 80s with what Bob Moog created. And like I said at the beginning, it's really hard to imagine there being another musical instrument invention this big in our lifetimes, or perhaps even ever again. Technical production for all this is by Rob Johnston. I'm Alan Cross.
You've been listening to The Ongoing History of New Music, a Deep Sky production.